going to talk about this morning is fitting symptomatic, putting theory into practice, translating research into routine laboratory practice. So we've got to know that the things that we're going to talk about this morning are fecal immunochemical tests, which detect fecal hemoglobin using antibodies to the globin moiety of that molecule. And they have many advantages. It's easy to collect feces with user-friendly hygienic collection devices. You only need one sample. There are no dietary interferences. They're much more specific diseases of the colorectum than the traditional wire FOBT. They're generally much more sensitive analytically. They detect much lower concentrations of blood and feces. And they're now recommended ubiquitously in guidelines for asymptomatic population screening. And the reason that they work in screening, of course, is that fecal hemoglobin concentration is related directly to colorectal disease severity. And as we go from normal, lower risk carcinoma, high risk carcinoma to cancer, the fecal hemoglobin concentration, as we've shown in considerable detail, rises. Now, if that's so in asymptomatic populations, why should it not be so in symptomatic people as well? So, in spite of the doubters and detractors, we set about some years ago investigating whether FIT could be used in assessment of the symptomatic, and studies from Scotland, Spain, England and elsewhere prove beyond doubt that quantitative FIT can be used to rule in cancer in symptomatic patients, but much more importantly, to rule out significant colorectal disease. And if this is so, then the number of referrals to donors could be cut. But you must remember, no test is perfect, and some adenomas and some inflammatory bowel disease could be missed, and also in some special circumstances, a very few colorectal cancers. So our new paradigm would look like this: the patients with symptoms who turn up in primary care get FIT. If the FIT is positive, refer for colonoscopy. If it's negative, then you could reassure most patients that they do not have significant colorectal disease, but establish what are called robust safety netting procedures, such as watching and waiting if symptoms persist, referring to secondary care to a gastric colleague, or even repeating the test. Now, in Scotland, the government is very keen on this, and late last year they produced this wonderful paper that said key cancer services are being redesigned. They want to cut colonoscopy, and they said we can do this with a new primary care diagnostic test being examined for national rollout, and the results of that examination will be described by Jane in a few moments. And the government is very, very knowledgeable. They say FIT is designed to rule out the presence of blood and feces, a key indicator of bowel disease. And it's very important to remember that we are talking here, in Scotland at least, not only about colorectal cancer and polyps, but also inflammatory bowel disease, Crohn's disease, and ulcerative colitis. As you are sure you know, after the controversial NICE NG12 cancer referral guidelines, NICE set up a diagnostics advisory committee to look at FIT and assessment of the symptomatic. And the draft guidelines and evidence base are available on the internet. Wonderful documents if you've got lots of time to read them. And their draft recommendation said quantitative FIT are recommended for routine adoption in primary care. And after Jane has spoken, then Sally will talk in great detail about what's happening in England and where we need to go next. So I'll hand over to Jane.
Okay, so as Callum said, I'm going to be speaking about our experience in NHST side of using FIT in patients presenting to primary care with bowel symptoms. So to give a background to the current work, the pilot study was conducted over a 6-month period towards the end of 2013 and into 2014, where 750 patients completed the OC sensor FIT test and underwent colonoscopy. Now, we looked at test performance characteristics. If we were to be using a cut-off of anything greater than 0 micrograms of hemoglobin per gram of feces, and that would have generated a positivity rate of around 60%, so a reduction in the levels of around 40%. Now, we can see that of the 28 cancers in the cohort, none of them would have been missed on that criteria. So this would give a negative predictive value of 100%, showing that FIT was a good rule-out test for colorectal cancer in the symptomatic patients. So moving on to the current work, we have two projects ongoing in the NHS Tayside at the moment. The first I'll describe is funded by the NHS Scotland's Detect Cancer Early campaign. So since December 2014, GPs in NHS Tayside have been encouraged to use FIT as part of the standard referral procedure in patients presenting with bowel symptoms. And under a separate research grant from the Scottish Government's Chief Scientist Office, we are looking to develop a clinical risk score incorporating fecal hemoglobin along with age, gender, symptoms and lifestyle data collected from patients completing a questionnaire when they're attending for colonoscopy and NHS data. So just to present some results from the first year of data that we have, so from December 2015 to December 2016, there were over 5,500 kits returned to the laboratory. You can see from the red line that the number of kits returned each month gradually increased as GPs got used to using the test, up to the level we're currently at of around 600 tests coming in per month. And the blue line shows the proportion of these kits who had with a result which was greater than 10 micrograms of hemoglobin per gram of feces. And this proportion was consistently around 20%. And there were 5% of all patients who had a fecal hemoglobin concentration which was above the upper limit of the working range of the analyzer, above 400 micrograms of hemoglobin per gram of feces. Looking at the clinical outcomes, these results come from around 1,300 patients who completed the FIT and had a colonoscopy completed. And we split these patients into three categories according to their fecal hemoglobin concentration. So the green bars show those with very high fecal hemoglobin concentration. The blue bars show those with fecal hemoglobin concentration less than 10. And the red bars are those in between. So you can see looking at the green and the red bars, particularly the green bars, that significant bowel disease, so colorectal cancer, high-risk adenoma, and inflammatory bowel disease was much more common in those with elevated fecal hemoglobin concentration compared to those with fecal hemoglobin concentration less than 10. You can see that there are 6 patients who had a fecal hemoglobin concentration less than 10 who had colorectal cancer diagnosed. However, all 6 of these had coexisting anemia, and as an alarm system, a symptom, this meant that they would have been referred in any case. So the ramifications for clinical practice are that we've shown a FIT investigation is an essential adjunct to history, examination and blood tests in the assessment of patients presenting in primary care with bowel symptoms. A fecal hemoglobin concentration less than 10 is reassuring primary care that serious bowel disease is unlikely and therefore FIT can be used as a rule-out test. And we also looked at the number of referrals made to through the gastroenterology pathways in NHS Tayside since the rollout of FIT in routine care, and compared this with the number of referrals from the previous year and found a significant reduction of 14%. At colonoscopy, the yield of cancer, high-risk adenoma and inflammatory bowel disease has increased and is high in those with a fecal hemoglobin concentration that is above 10 micrograms of hemoglobin per gram of feces. So what's next for Tayside in Scotland? It's hoped that funding can be secured soon for the continuation of the use of FIT as routine practice in NHS Tayside and also rolled out across the other health boards in Scotland. We are looking to continue with our questionnaire-based study to allow development of a clinical risk score. It may be as simple as that which we've already been involved in the development of along with colleagues from Spain, resulting in this publication in the International Journal of Cancer, which simply looked at fecal hemoglobin concentration, age and sex, and was termed the FAST score. So it's hoped that we can work on this later on in the year to develop something that might be able to be used in clinical practice identifying those patients who are at highest risk of having significant viral disease. Okay, I'll hand over to Sally.
Hi everyone. So I've been asked to give a bit of an overview of what's been happening in England in terms of FIT. We're not as advanced as they are at Scotland, but we're trying to get there. So as Callum touched on, in June 2015, the NICE guideline NG12 was published for suspected cancer, guiding GPs how to refer, and quite controversially, it included colorectal cancer and the inclusion of the faecal occult blood test. As I'm sure most of you here are aware, faecal occult blood test is very poor. I'm not sure what's happening here. The Guaya-FOB is an incredibly poor test analytically, with very poor analytical sensitivity and specificity, and as a result of this, most labs in the UK had already stopped offering the test. As a response to this, in November last year, NICE published this consultation document that recommended the use of the faecal immunochemical test in the NG12 guidelines. So in very, very brief, because as Callum touched on, it's quite a long document, the NICE recommendation is that FIT is used in primary care referral pathway for patients with suspected colorectal cancer, and this is in the low-risk group of patients. The recommendation recommends the use of one of three analyzers, and I should just note that there are four analytical systems available. The reason only the three of them are mentioned is because they're the only ones that have got data on the symptomatic population published. And the cutoff to be used is quoted to be 10 micrograms of hemoglobin per gram of feces. Again, we can discuss that in a little bit. So in terms of what's happening in NHS England as a whole, endoscopy services, I'm sure lots of you are struggling to deliver capacity to keep up with demand. They've got demand from screening programmes, the symptomatic population, and also patients undergoing surveillance if they've had cancer detected or polyps. As CRUK published a couple of years ago, demand is expected to increase significantly over the next few years. So the question is, does FIT provide a solution for us in England in terms of endoscopy capacity? So NHS England hosted a scoping workshop back in March this year to look at FIT for the symptomatic population. It was an incredibly well attended workshop. There were 52 attendees and we actually had to turn people away because, not on the day obviously, but there were lots of people that wanted to come, but because of the capacity of the room we had to turn people away, and I know a number of those are biochemists, so I apologise for that. But we had representation from gastroenterologists, surgeons, biochemists, GPs, NICE and the HTA charities were there, all the diagnostic companies. So it was a really well attended meeting, and the purpose of the workshop was to share any data that people have been collecting in England on FIT in the symptomatic population, to find out about any proposed projects that were going on or in progress, and to discuss the issues, challenges and gaps in knowledge and potential solutions. So just a very brief overview of the workshop. There was a background, bit of background where I ran through some of the laboratory issues. I'm not sure if issues is the right word, but that's what was on the programme. Then Robert Logan, a gastroenterologist from London, talked about the NICE guidelines. We then had some presentations from studies that are ongoing, and then most of the day was given up to discussion about what we do next. So just to run through very, very briefly what I touched on, and I'm not going to present any data here because there just isn't time. So pre-analytically, as I'm sure, there is a lot of variation in FIT tests that we all need to be aware of. So stool obviously isn't homogenous. The pickers from the manufacturers are different. So we'll collect different amounts of stool. And we've also got data to demonstrate that if you dip your picker into the stool, I get quite familiar with what about the poo at the moment, then whether you dip it once, twice or three times, for example, gives a different result. Analytically, there's a lot of variation. There's no assay standardisation. Different manufacturers have different buffers, different antibodies, and they're calibrated to different reference materials. And we are in the process of setting up an IFCC working group to look at this, but it's still work in progress. There's no established EQA scheme and no established independent IQC scheme. These slides are clicking on, I'm not sure why. We then had studies work from four different studies presented. I'm not going to present the data, partly because it's unpublished, again because of time, but each study had a different study approach. However, they did all demonstrate that FIT does have the potential as a rule-out test for colorectal cancer, so supporting the work that's been done in Scotland and elsewhere in the world. So I've just been asked to cover the main discussion points that were raised or that came up at the meeting. And they essentially split into two main areas, the evidence base for the test and the practicalities of implementing the test. In terms of evidence, there isn't a huge amount of evidence that supports the NICE Callum's looking at me. There's a particular lack of evidence from the English population. The evidence required to support this cutoff of 10, being the same of all analysers, is, well, there isn't evidence to demonstrate that you get the same cutoff on all analysers, the same result on all analysers. And does FIT actually decrease referral to colonoscopy? This is a question I get asked by lots of gastroenterologists. And there isn't actually any published evidence. I keep saying published, but I can see Callum glaring at me to support this. But I believe that Scotland are going to be presenting their work soon. In terms of practicalities, should FIT be requested in primary or secondary care? The NICE guidelines are recommending it in primary care, but I know there's a lot of discussion as to whether it should be a secondary care test. How do we safety net patients with a false negative test? So we need to think about that. There's some concern about confusion between the screening and symptomatic FIT. We're going to be introducing FIT into the screening programme in England in this time next year, and that will have a very high cutoff, and the symptomatic FIT cutoff is going to be very low. So it might be that both patients and healthcare professionals get confused. And then we need to consider practicalities and the impact of operationalising FIT into the diagnostic pathway. So inevitably, different organisations have different referral pathways. And there was also some discussion around how we get samples to labs and do patients host them. If so, that's, you know, we need to work out how that's going to work. So the identified difficulties in introduction of FIT in the assessment of the symptomatic population fell into basically the lack of local evidence, the different clinical pathways that will exist. There's no not necessarily one size fits all. And also it was acknowledged that not everybody is in favour of FIT, and that within the workshop it was very much a self-selected group of FIT enthusiasts, and we do know that there are quite a large group of gastroenterologists that aren't convinced by it yet, hence the need for more evidence. So possible solutions to these difficulties are basically that we need to generate more evidence, ideally in the English population. There was a lot of encouragement for any of the work that's being done at the moment to be published in peer-reviewed publications, to look at extending any studies. There's a couple of big studies in London going on, or about to start, whether we could recruit from more organisations, more hospitals, to increase the numbers more quickly to get data. And then to also consider how, as biochemists, we can feed into the clinical studies that are going on to look at the different analytical platforms and differences between them. So in terms of what is next for England, we're expecting the NICE Diagnostic Assessment Programme document, the final version to be published next month. The aim is across England and NHS England are supporting this and looking to get funding to support having some published data from England by the end of the year. But essentially, the decisions are going to be made locally as to whether to implement this or not. I know some places are already looking at implementing it and other places aren't. And that will all come down to the normal things, such as funding, you know, labs need to procure analysers or find referral labs, and then we need to consider where in the pathway FIT is requested. And that's done.
Thank you very much.